Greg Miller from Up at Noon. My father took me hunting once. He had never asked me before. Said I was too young, so you must understand how excited I was. He showed me how to load a gun, how to carry it, how to walk silently in the woods, and I was so proud, so proud. But when we came across the deer, I couldn't do it. Do you understand? I couldn't shoot it, but he made me. He made me kill the deer. And as the life drained from its eyes, he said, "That's what it means to be a man." So here's my extended interview with Giant Bomb's Jeff. As I live and breathe, Jeff Gerstmann.
Good to be here.
Thanks for coming, having me. I don't know. I was more worried about nailing the handshake, and I did it. This is 2 weeks in a
row. Handshakes are important.
The YouTube kids, they watch it. They don't like the bad handshake.
The YouTube kids, I mean, they know what it takes to be a man.
Yeah.
It's a firm handshake.
They do. They know something about being a man in those comments.
I read the comments. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, that's how you base your life now?
Yeah, pretty much.
All right.
Yeah.
So really uneventful spring for you.
Yeah, pretty much just
Not much going on. Yeah,
just
yeah.
been sitting around and, you know, no video games, no nothing.
No,
so
yeah,
I've
yeah.
been sleeping a lot, drinking a bunch.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Well, of course.
Well,
that's what
yeah,
we got to
I mean,
do.
Yeah.
Now, if people at home don't know you, you're Jeff from Giant Bomb. You've been in the video game industry forever. You cover them. You're one of those games journalists I keep reading about.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
okay.
Sure.
Now, you work at GameSpot for 10 years. They can you. They say, get the hell out of here.
Yeah.
And this whole hullabaloo.
Yeah.
You go to Giant Bomb.
Mm-hmm.
Then CBS buys Giant Bomb. And so now you're back with GameSpot. So it's like basically the Empire bought the Rebels, and now you're all on the same base and just walking around going, man, hey.
Hey, what's up, man? Yeah, good to see you again. It's been 4 years.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, you know, like, it's slightly more nuanced
than
that.
Oh, is it? All right.
But yeah, not too far
well,
off.
Walk
yeah.
me through it. You had been at GameSpot forever.
Yeah,
then...
I mean, I started there in 96 mm-hmm. When they decided they wanted to get into covering these console games they'd
yeah.
heard so
they
much about.
They might take off one day.
Yeah, hopefully. I mean, you know, fingers crossed, yeah. but we'll see. And then, yeah, it was an independent company back then. It got picked up by Ziff Davis, and we were partnered with EGM and all that stuff. And then that split up when ZDNet got bought by CNET, and then we were at part of CNET, and then I got fired. And
I was asleep for most of that, but then you said fired. What happened? What was the deal here? Now?
Well, what the deal was is, you know, it's there was a lot of transitions happening. You know, Greg Kasavin, who had been there almost as long as mm-hmm. I had taken off, and there was kind of a new management changes. And really, top to bottom, through the whole company, the founder of the company was the CEO, and you know, he was out, and there was this whole fresh regime in there. And it was people that didn't necessarily understand the value of an editorial department,
right,
and what they're supposed
voice,
to be doing.
Being able to say that this is good or bad.
Yeah, being able to say, like, this game is not great, even if that game happens to be an advertiser. So, you know, it led to some awkward conversations to which most of my responses were like, I don't care. I can't care
yeah.
about anything you're telling me. And then finally they said, like, you need to get your stuff and go. So I did.
And that's when you became a household name.
Yeah, it was
overnight.
It was weird. Penny Arcade ran a comic strip about it, and then it all kind of blew up from there.
So what was your reaction, though? I mean, like, I've worked for IGN for 5.5 years now,
yeah.
and that would be mind-boggling to me right now. And granted, I came in, like, just about all the time this stuff started happening, or right before then. So I remember, you know, IGN got pulled together, and they said to us, you know, flat out, this is, you know, there's a yeah. wall between advertising and editorial.
Mm-hmm.
We never want you guys to worry about this.
Right.
But, so what was your reaction? I'm assuming you thought there was that wall, right?
Yeah, I mean, you always assume that that wall is there until suddenly it's not, basically.
I hope that wall never goes away,
yeah.
right? Right, Pam? All right. Lair.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure. And it's one of those things that, you know, you kind of just operate as normal, and then all of a sudden normal isn't seen as normal by people around you anymore.
Yeah.
And you're like, wait a minute, this, maybe we should get out of here. And then before you know it, like, you're packing your stuff into your car and going. So yeah, I spent a couple of days on the couch just sitting around going like, man, what am I going to do? And there was that notion of like, well, I guess I could just do like the big sellout move and become a community manager or producer like everyone else who gets out of
uh-huh.
reviewing games. Then like the Penny Arcade thing happened, the phone kind of started ringing, and it was weird because, you know, like at GameSpot, I don't know if you know this about GameSpot.
Oh, please tell me all these secrets.
We had kept it pretty insular.
Yeah.
Didn't necessarily get out and talk a lot. So you ended up in this situation where you had no idea if you were worth anything at all. You know, it's like we were hosting on the spot and doing all this stuff and, uh-huh. you know, doing all these videos, and you could look at the numbers and go like, oh, millions of people are seeing this every day. That's great. Oh, and all these people read this review. Outstanding. But it isn't, you know, you had no real physical interaction with people. And so it wasn't until all that happened and people started kind of reaching out and, you know, like, Norwegian newspaper called my parents at 3 a.m. looking for comment. And it got really crazy. Like, you know, LA Times is calling me, like, looking for the dirt, like trying to run hatchet job stories and all sorts of stuff. And
good promo for the LA Times.
It was a lot of weird phone calls and a lot of people just trying to like figure out what the heck happened. Like Ballywag was around back then, the Gawker site that was devoted to gossip. And they had like a section, like a tag on the site that was devoted to this thing. And like minutes of meetings that were happening in the GameSpot offices were leaking out of those meetings onto Ballywag and stuff. And it was just, it was a really crazy circus to watch. And it made it very easy to start something new.
at that point,
So, you know, I ended up partnering up with a lot of guys. Actually, at one point, all of the people there were ex-CNET. It was Shelby Bonney, who was one of the founders, who had been the CEO. And then, you know, some of the designers and other guys that had left to go kind of start their own thing, and they'd been doing ComicVine.com for comics.
Another Whiskey Media.
Yeah, another Whiskey Media. So it's us and ComicVine that went over. And then we started doing that, did it for about 4 years, and then started looking like, oh, you know, maybe there's something bigger we'd be doing, maybe there's something more interesting we'd be getting into, and then just started having a ton of conversations.
Was there hesitation? I mean, when they came to you and were like,
well, our biz guys kind of came to me and said like, would it be weird for you if we started talking to CBS, who had bought CNET in the years following? And I said, it'd be really weird, but let's do it. I mean, let's talk to everybody, because you know, at that point, everyone that had made some what I felt were pretty bad decisions were long gone.
Okay.
You know, there's a good crew in there already, you know, John Davison and you know, a lot of people that I'd worked with for a very long time, guys like Justin Calvert and stuff like that, who had just been, you know, at GameSpot and just rock solid dudes.
Sure.
So knowing that kind of the regime had changed, it made it a lot easier to talk to them.
But were there meetings where you went in to make sure that was still the case though?
Absolutely. You know, I started talking to John and some of the other guys over there around like December, and I think the first thing that when we first met, I said, you realize if we do this, if this actually happens, like we have to tell the story about me getting fired. Like this doesn't work if we don't get that out of the way. I think that was one of the interesting things for them, because it was something that they were actually still dealing with on a regular basis.
I have to imagine, because for a lot of people, right, like, because you were talking about, like, Norwegian papers are picking this up, LA Weekly, people who don't read games are only hearing about GameSpot in this bad sense, right?
And it was like the day before we announced the deal, I was reading a story about, you know, like the gender stuff with Poison, the Final Fight character.
Yeah.
And there was a comment on there going like, this story sucks, you hadn't fired Jeff Gerstmann. And it was like the day before we announced the thing, I'm sitting there reading it going, well, we'll see how this goes, this will be real crazy.
So what was the reaction from like this, because you figure Giant Bomb got fueled by all these people who came with you and said, this is the right stance to make, this is what you guys should be doing. Were they then like, oh, sell out and blah, blah, blah.
Well,
die, Brad Shoemaker.
Well, yeah, I mean, there's the Zy Brad Shoemaker thing is pretty constant, regardless of who owns the company.
He's just too good looking is the problem.
Yeah, pretty much. Like, I'm trying to cut his throat most days. And he sits right next to me, so I'm not very good at it. But I'll get there eventually.
You keep trying.
Yeah.
Play some move games. Get your wrists
That'll always do it. That'll always do it. These wrists are weak. I don't have, I need to work them up a little bit more. It was, what was the question?
I don't know. Oh, how mad were the people? Were people mad? Were you called to sell it the next day?
I mean, you know, it was something we had to work through like really long and hard and think about, you know, what are people going to say about this stuff? Is it too crazy? And I think that's why it didn't leak ahead of time, other than it, like 15 minutes early, I think it ended up leaking out. But it was one of those things that was so crazy that even if anyone heard it, they would never believe it, because it was so over the top. And I think we were able to kind of address like the main concerns that people would have about like, you know, why would you go back in there knowing what they did to you? It's like, well, these aren't the people.
Yeah.
This is a completely different
company's
group.
Company's changed.
It's a very different company now. So I think by kind of, we just kind of expected that this is how it would go. And when we actually made the announcement, we made it our way. We did it live. We ate pancakes, and there were technical difficulties, and it was half broken, and you know, like a traditional kind of
giant bomb.
Exactly. Like, it started about 15 minutes late, that sort of thing, like a regular live stream would. And we were able to just kind of say like, look, this is what we're doing. This is why we're doing it. And I think people were able to understand that this in the long run it'll mean kind of a bigger and better Giant Bomb for them. So you know, right now we're going through the process of, like, none of our equipment moved over. It was weird.
Of course.
So it ends up being this process now where we're just, like, building huge shopping lists.
How
are you,
being Mr. Giant Bomb, ensuring that you don't lose that it doesn't just become an arm of, you know, Giant GameSpot or whatever and lose its identity?
Well, I think that, you know, like, basically, like, I don't really necessarily have any direct responsibilities that involve GameSpot, because they have that kind of covered, and I've done that before.
Yeah, old.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, like I'm coming into, you know, like I have a lot of advice about things that they're doing and stuff like that. But yeah. You know, I'm pretty much primarily focused on Giant Bomb. And making sure that we're continuing to do the things we do. So, you know, it's not like we're plugging right into their E3 plans and I'm going right back and hosting their stage show like I used to do or anything insane like that.
You've gotten bigger than that. You're better than that now.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, I don't want to sit there. It's like, yeah, I'm going to sit in the booth for 3 full days under hot
lights. You've got to be out there.
Yeah, I've got to be out there making things happen.
Touching people, being all sweaty. Yeah.
Pressing
E3.
The flesh. E3. Yeah. Getting all these free T-shirts.
Now, you talk about giving advice. You're, like I said, you've become this, like, the mecca of video game journalism, or whatever, for so many people.
Yeah.
What are the advice you give to people who want to get into the industry?
Oh man, you should know the right people and work them for a job. Basically, it's you know, like that's the weirdest thing is that is the number one question. But I think everyone has such a completely different story about how it happened for them that there really is no one true way. Other than I guess you know if you get to a point where you're getting an interview or something like that, don't seem like a crazy person.
That's good.
Like that's a really helpful one. If you get in there and be like, I think I'm better than you at this video game. Like, you're not even getting to the next phase. You're like, okay, that's totally not what we're hiring for. You need to be able to write and communicate and that sort of stuff. You know, like 5-6 years ago, we started joking like that we should start looking for headshots when we're hiring people because it's moved into such a video realm and all that sort of stuff. And obviously, it's not
hired.
There yet. Yeah.
So, you know. If you look like this,
yeah.
Get your own show.
Hasty white dudes, just line up. We're hiring them all. So we have not quite gotten to that point yet, thankfully. But yeah, I don't. You know, you have to be able to be natural on camera. And now, you know, I think live video is becoming a bigger part of it. So I think it's just a matter of developing that well-rounded skill set. And then also being super passionate about games and kind of knowing a lot about that stuff.
When people talk to you and meet you for the first time on a plane or however you meet people, I meet people on planes only.
Yeah.
How do you describe...
Meet me on this flight how to do you Detroit.
I love getting in there for the Cinnabon, and then I got to go on the flight anyway. How do you describe yourself? Do you say you're a games journalist? What does that mean nowadays? Because one of those things, people love to throw that rock at us when we talk about games.
Yeah, I often say that I write about games because I think when you say journalist, it comes with like certain overtones of you know press band or hat in the press band and notepad and crime scenes and stuff
like
that.
Hey, I got a scoop for you.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, and that's not necessarily what we do on a daily basis. So I tend to say that I write about games, and then they inherently go what? Actually, they say,
Oh, you write games. Yeah.
Like, no. I write about them, like, kind of tell people what's coming out and that sort of stuff. A friend of mine, after kind of seeing over the last 4 years, like, I don't know if it's like this for you. It's really hard to describe what you do even to close friends.
Oh, sure.
And it was really only over the last 4 years when we started doing live events and having people come, and I would invite, you know, friends that weren't in the industry. Like, now they finally understand it, and one of them started describing me as the Roger Ebert of video games, which I'm not going to say, like, no way. but that at least gets the point across, I think, to people that don't understand what it is that we
totally
do.
No, totally. I'm in the same boat as that. I like to say I'm a game critic. I don't like to say that I'm a games journalist.
Right.
Being trained in journalism, having a degree in journalism, I think what we do is very different. You know what I mean? Like, I remember I wouldn't drink a bottle of water at a press event back when I was writing for a newspaper. And here we get, you know, you go on these trips and you're put up at hotels and you're playing games and they're giving you food. And you're like, okay, well, this doesn't influence my score, but in the same breath, like, it's completely different from what I was doing.
Exactly, yeah. And I think it's important to make that distinction for sure. And I think game critic is something that is kind of a rising term. I think it's one of those things where there is that kind of difference between doing just like basic product reviews, like your Consumer Reports or something like that, and then getting into actual criticism. And I think like that's games are feeling like they're finally getting to that point of relevance culturally that maybe that shift can start to happen more and more, that we can get into actual real honest criticism.
How far away are we? I mean, you know, when movies came out, right? Everybody was like, oh, these are for kids, these are blah, blah, blah.
Right.
And it seems like we're still going through. Basically, I want everyone, like in Congress, they need to die. They need to get old and die.
Yeah, that's.
And then the young people need to, you know, grow up and take those jobs.
Exactly.
And then it would be seem
like that is weirdly, that is total. I could not agree more. The solution to this problem is just complete death from all. Video games are in that phase right now where some people still think it's like Elvis shaking his hips on Ed Sullivan or something like that,
right.
Just, you know, it's the devil and we got to keep him out of our kids' hands. They're ruining lives. And, you know, I think as those people age out of existence, we won't have that problem anymore.
Pretty much.
Well, Jeff, if only there was a way we could help it alone.
No time for that.
All right.
Jeff, thank you so much for being on.
Anytime.
All right, great. Thank you for watching that extended interview with Jeff. Want to see me and Jeff get into a slap fight? Then like this video and leave a comment below. Make sure you watch the full episode of Up at Noon right here, then click here to subscribe to start. I wish I could cry bees so I could sting every person who's ever hurt me.